Next week, we're going to make our fourth and final attempt to locate the wreck of a Douglas A-20B Havoc light bomber flown by Captain Don E. Brown, the son of the famous comedian Joey Brown. And Donnie Brown crashed regrettably to his death on October 8, 1942. He was assigned to the Air Transport Command and specifically to a ferry squadron. And he was in the company of another A-20. They had come from Long Beach, California. They had landed at Palm Springs. And as they departed Palm Springs, they were to go on to Las Vegas, Nevada, and finally to Ogden, Utah. But shortly after takeoff from Palm Springs, the pilot of the other A-20 noticed that Captain Brown's engines were simply, the props were simply windmilling, and that Brown put the aircraft nose down to keep up airspeed. He made a turn and tried to line up for an emergency landing on the desert with his landing gear retracted, and it seemed to go well at first, sliding across the sands until he struck a series of boulders that caused the airplane to flip over. And it was at that point a fire did break out on the aircraft. Brown was able to extricate himself and crawl away from the wreck. BT-13, an Army BT-13 flying nearby, saw this happening. He landed on a roadway, shut his engine down, and ran like crazy over a quarter mile to reach Captain Brown. He was able to help Captain Brown get further away from the A-20, and unfortunately, within 15 minutes, Captain Donnie Brown expired from severe internal injuries and skull fracture. So this is the airplane that we hope to find, and this is a model of an A-20, A or B, in markings 1940-41, and the airplane that Captain Brown was flying was olive drab overall. And normally you'd have a three-person crew, but it was a delivery flight, so he was the sole person on board. So with good fortune, we hope to locate this aircraft and the final resting place of that A-20B, lost on October 8, 1942.
The Douglas A-20 Havoc began life, actually, as the DB-7. And the United States Army Air Corps was not the first to order the aircraft. The French were. The clouds of war were gathering over Europe, and Douglas was rushing production from its Santa Monica facility. Many of those French airplanes arrived in time to participate in the opening of the war for the French when the Germans attacked in May of 1940. And the DB-7 gave good account of itself. When France collapsed, some of those DB-7s made it to North Africa, and the British, the Royal Air Force, picked up the rest of the contract. But in the meantime, our own Air Force said, wait a minute, this is looking like a very successful aircraft, and large orders were made for the DB-7, which we call the A-20 Havoc. The British called it the Boston. Now, the aircraft was produced from 1939 until 1944, and 7,478 examples were produced. The crew would normally be two or three men, a pilot, a gunner aft, and with the clear nose, a bombardier forward. In the strafer version, which had guns in the nose, used very successfully, especially in the Southwest Pacific Theater of Operations. Also, the P-70 Night Fighter variant, that carried a pilot and a radar operator, who could also serve as a gunner as well to defend the aircraft. The P-70 also served in the Pacific Theater of Operations. Very successful aircraft designed by Ed Heinemann, and could carry a 2,000-pound bomb load. It also served with other air forces. We sent them to the Soviet Union in large numbers under Lend-Lease, and they employed the aircraft all the way to the end of the war and long after. They didn't retire the type until the early 1950s. They were still in service with the Far East Air Force for the Soviets. Brazil received the type as well, as did South Africa. An outstanding design, rugged, durable, dependable, and a great light attack, bomber, and night fighter aircraft.
So as we're walking, we find the area where Donnie Brown's airplane hit the ground, skimmed along the ground until it came to a sudden stop at a pile of rocks. And that sudden stop is what killed him. Well, here's some material from the A-20B that Captain Don E. Brown was flying. And this metal has been out here since 1942. And it's old style construction, late 30s, early 40s technology. There's skin, definitely aircraft. There's some corrosion. There was some fire on the site, so some of the metal's degraded. But this is a very important and historic site.
Boss had just flipped them upside down. Is that what the conjecture is?
Yeah, the nose dug in, broke off, went under the plane. The plane flipped because it was, you know,
he's over here.
Well, thanks to Tom and his ability to recognize things in the ground that really didn't show up as bright aluminum per se, because it's been burned. Evidence of slag of material that's just been melted into the sand in this position. Various just small parts in this, actually one particular area. I would think maybe 30 foot diameter will be about as big as the debris field is here. It's very small, but you can tell that there was evidence of fire and molten metal at this point. And this is where we believe that the airplane came to rest and then burned. Not too far from the road, about a quarter of a mile from the road.
Well, we're looking at parts here from the A-20B, and we wouldn't have this opportunity had it not been for Tom Maloney, as we're doing our grid search out here. Trip number 4. We got lucky not on the third time's a charm, but the fourth time. And we're right at the area where the A-20 hit the rocks, flipped over. And, of course, there are some parts with prefix numbers or numbers, sub-assembly numbers. Not, this is broken off, so we don't have the complete series on this. And here we see, of course, always the flag is in position out of respect for Captain Don E. Brown and his death on October 8th, 1942. Even though this is a very micro site, it's really less than 1% of the A-20B, it is still very significant. This is an early World War II loss, and of course the pilot was famous because of his dad.
We're here to remember Captain Don E. Brown, United States Army Air Force, who lost his life in the crash of a Douglas A-20B. And thanks to Tom Maloney, after hours of searching today, long day, early start, Tom stumbled upon some parts. We're right here at the final impact of Captain Don E. Brown's Douglas A-20 Havoc light attack bomber. We remember and honor his good service to our nation.